Welcome to Health and Harmony Beyond the Teeth, where we dive into all subjects that will help you become healthier and happier. As a dentist, I believe dentistry is more than just teeth, so I created this show to focus on overall health. We will hear from leading experts about eating better, exercising better, breathing better, and sleeping better. We want to help you create harmony in your life so you can live your life to the fullest. We want you to thrive. Hello and welcome to Health and Harmony Beyond the Teeth. I'm Dr. Hal Stewart, your host. And today I'm very happy to introduce our guest, Dr. Ben Miraglia. Ben, thanks for being with us today.
Oh, it's my pleasure, Hal. Thanks for having me.
I really look forward to this. And you're going to really get a lot out of these next series of lectures. We're going to have Dr. Miraglia do a four, maybe a five-part series. Today will be the first one. But before we start, let me give you a little introduction for Dr. Miraglia. He's been in private practice 29 years in Mount Kisco, New York. It's about an hour north of New York City. He's been doing early growth and development for children for 19 years. And he'll tell you a little bit more about that. But he's literally changed thousands of children's lives over the years. And I was just talking to him about how amazing that some of these kids that he's treated will really never really appreciate what he's done for them. But seeing the differences we make in kids in my own practice, and I haven't been doing it as long as Dr. Miraglia has, but it really is amazing. So you're in for a treat. Dr. Miraglia is also the board of directors for the American Academy of Physiological Medicine and Dentistry. And he is also on the President's Council of Northern Westchester Hospital. So he stays busy, and we're really pleased that he could actually come here to Big D, Dallas, Texas, and record these podcasts. So, Ben, welcome.
Thank you, Hal. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here. The timing was perfect, so I'm excited to talk all this through with you and be part of your podcast.
So just on a personal standpoint, tell me, do you have kids?
Yes, three of them.
You have three kids. So, How old are they?
So I have 21, 20, and 15.
Oh, okay.
So one just graduated from college. Mm-hmm. The second one is going to be a junior, and the third one's a sophomore in high school.
Oh, okay.
So we're knee-deep in it.
And being on the board of directors for the PMD and on the President's Council and with three kids, and I'm sure your wife's in there somewhere.
Yes, of course. Yeah, happily married. We just celebrated 23 years.
Oh, well, congratulations.
So we have a wonderful 23rd anniversary we just passed, and yeah, it's a juggling act. You know, you got a lot going on between private practice, teaching, because, I can only have a small effect in my own little community.
Right.
So even though we think about 19 years, 1,000 kids or more, that's really a drop in the bucket when you have a nationwide problem going on.
Yeah.
So I began teaching other doctors, because if you could then teach other doctors and they can have an impact in their community, this could snowball a little bit.
Sure.
So now I divide my time between the office and teaching.
Yeah. Well, and I'm a product of Dr. Miraglia's teaching. I've taken his pediatric and adult course, and I can't get enough of it. Actually, I think I'm auditing the one coming up in September again. So I'm right there with you. We can only do so much. We can only treat so many patients. But if we can teach others, then it just exponentiates. So, Ben, as you well know, we have a pandemic, and people can't breathe. And this is not something that's just in civilized societies. It's all over the world. Interestingly enough, though, it does concentrate in societies where that are more civilized, that have processed foods and things like that. And we'll get into a little bit of that in a moment. But there are still cultures out there that don't have the health issues that we have in more developed countries. And there's a reason for that. And I'm sure that you'll touch on that. So one of the reasons people can't breathe easy or breathe as well as they should is because their jaws are too small.
Yes.
Touch on that a little bit, Ben. I learned most of this from Ben. So I'm gonna quit yakking and let him educate you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Hal. So that's pretty much my favorite topic is the underdeveloped jaw topic. And that a lot of that information comes from anthropology research. And so I was introduced early to Dr. Robert Coricini. Dr. Robert Coricini is an anthropologist who has done most of his research in the malocclusion category. And so what we ended up learning from him and others like him, he's not the only one, but he's like the most prominent one out there. His research was focused on jaw growth and development, and as he traveled the world and was invited to grave sites to dig and then learn about the skulls from generations going back, they also were tracking over time cultures going forward. And so when you look at cultures that are isolated or primitive or aboriginal or natural living, basically we would label them today as non-industrial or non-Western living. Those types of cultures have a pathway for their growth and development. And it turns out it's breastfeeding is followed by a hard diet. And so it's an interesting thing that the anthropology community learned, like, oh, look at this. The food product after breastfeeding or with a mixture of breastfeeding is hard food. And then the child graduates to harder foods. Yeah. And the meat products in those communities are basically what we would call a jerky product, like a beef jerky or a turkey jerky. Those products are cured. So when you have no refrigeration or processing or preserving, you're going to take the meat products and go through a curing process. The curing process with a little bit of salt involved ends up becoming like a leather product.
Yeah.
But even the infants gnaw on it. So most interestingly, in a non-industrial, non-Western society, you would have breastfeeding followed by a hard diet. And what they learned was that hard diet usually is introduced between 6 and 9 months old. So now we have 6 and 9 months old introduced to hard food. They're gnawing on things along the way. And what happens is the breastfeeding kind of trains and strengthens the tongue to function properly. But the hard diet continues the process. When the hard diet is introduced and now you have a mixture of breastfeeding and hard food, gradually the child will graduate away from the breastfeeding into just a hard diet for the rest of their life. But the early years, that first 1 to 2 years of life where you're chewing and gnawing on hard things, you're working your jaw muscles significantly. That jaw muscle work promotes the bone growth in the jaws. So it turns out it's the anthropology community that teaches us an early hard diet is what keeps the jaw muscles strong and functioning properly to deliver fully grown jaws. Now, fully grown jaws come with 32 teeth.
Yeah.
So human beings are supposed to have all their body parts when we're done growing, and 32 teeth is right there at the top of the list. So when we think about fully grown jaws, we would think about, well, did the child grow and have their jaws go all the way to place and have 32 teeth set in position where they don't require orthodontics or movement of the teeth to line them up? And in cultures that are pre-industrial, pre-Western, where the early hard diet is involved, these children grow up and have 32 teeth and they don't have an orthodontic need. The teeth go pretty much where they belong, and there's no variation. No matter where you look on the planet, they learn there's very little variation in the jaw growth. It's fully developed, 32 teeth, and what we would consider like a beautiful or textbook type of bite. Mm-hmm. No orthodontics needed. Now, what we're getting to in that is when the jaws are growing fully and we see beautiful teeth, that's one thing. But underneath the jaws is space for air to flow. So human beings are obligate nasal breathers. So as an obligate nasal breather, that means your lips are sealed, your tongue is in the roof of your mouth, and you're breathing through your nose day and night. And that's 24/7, 365. So when your jaws grow fully, you have more space to breathe through. Now, the space to breathe through, loosely in dentistry, we use the word airway. Yeah. So in medicine and dentistry, airway has been the buzzword over the last 5 to 10 years. So airway, airway, airway. And a lot of people hear about airway through the sleep apnea talk, because you start hearing about, oh, obstructive sleep apnea, OSA, I have apnea, I have a CPAP. So these are the things that are out there in the community. Well, really what it has to do with is your airway. Now, airway is, it's a great word, but it's not a structure, it's a space.
Yeah.
But that space is directly affected by your jaw growth and development. So when your jaws grow fully and you have 32 teeth, you have a full home for the tongue. And you have a beautiful passage so the air can get from your nose all the way to your lung beautifully. No resistance, let's say. Easy breathing. Easy nasal breathing. Now, then the opposite happens. The anthropology research shows us with cultures that start to kind of graduate towards industrial Western living, as an isolated or natural culture begins to change towards industrial Western patterns of life, one of the earliest things that happens is food trade. And it's the trade of food that marks the difference. And it can happen in two categories. And we learned one of them rather quickly in our dental school program, but the other one was kind of left out. We didn't really pick it up. So I'll give you both little tidbits there. The first was in the cavity category. So we would look at populations that had no sugar in their diet. And the Inuit people is a very common example of Well, we're living on seafood mostly, and we don't have sugar or carbohydrate in the diet. So we would learn that, hey, Inuit cultures have almost no incidence of decay. They don't get cavities. Well, there's no sugar or carbohydrate in the diet to produce a cavity. Well, that's ingredients. The other direction that anthropology learned was that when you have all of a sudden food trade, well, those cultures would have the seafood or catching the fish. We would have the sugar or the carbohydrate to trade. Mm. Hey, let's trade.
Okay.
Let's trade, right? All of a sudden, the Inuit
introduced into their culture.
Yes. Yeah. Now the sugar gets introduced in the culture. You start eating that. What do you get? Cavities.
Yeah.
So anthropology taught us that, oh, if you have no sugar in your diet, you're going to have little to no cavity exposure. Meanwhile, when those food trades begin, you start getting cavities in those populations. Mm. So you can get a lot of decay. Well, what happens is that natural lifestyle that has a hard diet, with the early hard diet going on, their jaws grow beautifully. You have 32 teeth. But with food trade, not only do you get the sugar or carbohydrate ingredient, but it becomes a softer food. So when you start thinking about cultures as they transition from natural.
It's more processed.
Yes, yeah. More processed. We call it processed, preserved, prepared.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are words we'll use for softer foods. But basically the diet becomes softer and softer and softer by the generation. So a generation could be 20 years. As time's passing, cultures that had a hard diet exclusively in about 100 years can swing to a fully soft diet. So we think about today, currently in America, the food is soft. We generally have a soft diet. Mm-hmm. And when we're thinking about infancy, it's baby food. So it's mush. Yeah. And if it's not
Go to the grocery store. If you're listening to this, go to the grocery store and look at the foods for infants.
Yes.
They're all pureed in jars.
Yeah. and for the parents who don't go to the grocery store to get that, of course, with a 21, 20, and 15-year-old, when my kids were little, we ran to the farmer's market, and we would get all of the fresh fruits, vegetables, and things, but we'd come home and put it in the magic bullet, blender. Yeah. We would mash it up to a puree. So I did the same thing. It's not like, oh, I know how to do it right. I've learned some of it by mistake and the hard way.
Yeah.
And of course, those are some of the lessons along the way. Oh yeah, I fed my kids all that mush early. So when you transition to a full soft diet and you think about the kids today, we go from breastfeeding to the baby food, which today is all mush. So whether it's from the store or from the farmer's market, if we put it in a blender, it's coming out as a puree. It's a liquid diet, basically. Mm-hmm. But with that early soft diet, what happens is the early soft diet, you're not required to use your musculature. So now your muscles will remain weak and small. If the jaw muscles are drinking the diet, mostly for the first year or two, all of a sudden weak and small muscles don't promote bone growth. So in a human being, the bone does react to the muscles. So you're not necessarily programmed, oh, I'm a human, my bone will grow to its size. No, it has to do with a number of factors. One is nutrition. And the other is, we know from the anthropology research, the consistency of the food makes the biggest difference.
Mm-hmm.
So our anthropologists have shown us, by looking backwards and forwards through cultures, they can time the generation where the early soft diet was introduced to the then finding, let's say, what we would call loosely the crowded bad teeth.
Yeah.
Because what people would see immediately from underdeveloped jaws, if your jaws are too small, your teeth are crowded and you have a bad bite. So one of the first things you notice from underdeveloped jaws is, well, bad teeth, crowded bad teeth.
Yeah.
So then anthropology, they take it a step further. So now they learn like, oh, wow, it's the consistency of the food that is the number one reason why a human being's jaws are too small to fit all their teeth. The next level is, hey, we should try to test this model a little bit. So they develop hard and soft diet studies. And they test it on animal groups as they're growing, as they're young. So basically what they do is they take an animal group, for example, they'll divide it in half. It's a young and growing animal group. They're going to take their normal habitat diet. So you take the animal's normal habitat diet and half of the group is going to get it naturally as they would find it in their environment.
Mm-hmm.
The other half is going to get exactly the same food, only blended. Okay. It'll be pureed.
Yeah.
So like we could say, oh, if it's a rabbit, if we're talking about a rabbit, here's a carrot. Mm-hmm. You can eat it whole and chew it and gnaw on it. Or we're going to blend it. Here's your carrot juice.
Okay.
Yep. Well, it turns out they grow totally different then.
Mm-hmm.
Same food. Different consistency. So anthropology has shown us in multiple models for decades of these hard, soft diet studies that just taking a food and pureeing it to a mush will change how an individual will grow.
Yeah.
And it's not just restricted to the jaws. It turns out that that animal group, in our case, it's humans, In the animal group that is humans, you would have a smaller body mass. You'd have less dense bone body wide, not just your jaws. But then primarily it was right in the head and neck. The jaws would be smaller, narrower, more vaulted. Your teeth would then be crowded. You'd have underdeveloped jaws. Mm-hmm. So I learned about the cavity part in dental school. That I remember. They told us, they taught us about, hey, the origins of decay is really rooted in your sugar and carbohydrate intake. Right. And then they showed us the difference in cultures as they were introduced to it. The part that I did not learn in dental school, which took afterwards being introduced to anthropology research, gentlemen like Dr. Robert Corcini, Dr. Jerome Rose, there are many out there and still teaching it today, was the consistency. So it turns out the consistency of the early diet between, you know, 0 and 2 is the biggest impact on the jaw growth and development. And that's because a human being from 0 to 2, that's the point in time, the range where you earn or get 54% of your jaw growth and development. So from 0 to 2 is most, the majority of your jaw growth and development. And 2 to 4 is the second biggest increment. It's about 10 to 15% there. So when you think about a 4-year-old, you're going 54 and another 10, we'll say 64 to 70. 64 to 70% of the jaw growth occurs up until 4 years old. And it turns out that's really where the corresponding soft diet is.
Yeah.
So from 0 to 2 and then 2 to 4, we're having this early soft diet and it's ubiquitous, meaning it's everybody does it.
Right.
Very few kids grow up with what would have been considered a natural hard diet, which means it translates into underdeveloped jaws, crowded teeth, bad bite, but what's underneath is the airspace. So having smaller jaws means having less room for air to flow. So we could think about a tube, you know, a tube people kind of think about and see clearly in that if we breathe in our nose and it has to get to the lung, we'll call it a tube. It's a space. Well, if you have an early hard diet, what is shown, then your jaws grow really well. You could have a tube that's like a garden hose. It's a big space compared to a coffee straw. So everybody who has coffee knows what that little straw does, but it's very tiny. If your jaws don't grow very well, there's less room for the air to flow through that space. A smaller space for airflow means trouble breathing well through your nose. And that triggers a cascade that I'm sure we're going to get into as we go.
It really is amazing. And yes, we are going to do that. What are some things parents can look for? Well, I mean, obviously, if you look in your kid's mouth and they've got teeth coming in and they're crooked, they're crowded. That's one thing. What are some other things parents can look for when they're looking at their child? And
sure.
That might be tipping off that maybe the jaws aren't growing correctly.
Yep. So when the jaws are underdeveloped, that's exactly right. The first thing you would see as a parent would be either crowded teeth or a bad bite. The teeth don't look perfect. They don't look exactly where they should be. So when you have crowded teeth and or a bad bite, you have underdeveloped jaws are the cause of that. Then there are a full list of symptoms that parents would recognize in their children, but not necessarily connected to the jaws. And at the top of that list would be behavioral issues, followed by bedwetting, night sweats, night terrors. You know, a lot of things that are connected to jaw growth and development aren't necessarily put together by the parent. But now that we have research in sleeping and breathing, we start to learn that, hey, these things are related. And not the least of which would be digestive issues as well. Parents would recognize children having digestive issues. That could be at either end, the top or the bottom of the digestive system. Yeah. So when we're thinking about some of the more common things, the behavioral issues top the list. Academic struggles are topping that list. Bedwetting, nightmares, night terrors, digestive issues, ear infections. Ear infections show up, you know, regularly in children that have underdeveloped jaws. And they might even come in having rounds of antibiotics over time and or getting ear tubes, all of which can certainly help a child, but they treat in the symptom category. And there's a big difference between treating the symptom or treating the cause.
Right.
So we have a big interest in treating the cause. And so I base my whole philosophy on, well, if the early soft diet delivers the underdeveloped jaws, my job then is to correct that. I need to develop the jaw structure fully so the child will not only have all 32 teeth, but end up with an appropriate amount of airspace to breathe through. I need a nasal breathing child 24/7, 365 to have a healthy child.
Yeah. And the importance of nasal breathing. Physiologically, what's happening when we breathe through our mouth versus our nose?
Oh yeah, it's a huge difference, So human beings are obligate nasal breathers, which means we were built to breathe through our nose. We were built to breathe through our nose exclusively. That's every single inhale and exhale. The mouth was not built to breathe through. And so just because air can flow through the mouth, it becomes a protective mechanism. It's a form of compensation. So we were designed very well. But what happens is the nose, being built to filter, to warm, to humidify, to accelerate, basically to prepare the air for the lung. If we breathe through the nose, the air is prepared so well for the lung that when it gets to the lung can do its job at basically what we would say optimum efficiency. It would function perfectly. But if we breathe through the mouth, the air doesn't get filtered or warmed or humidified or prepared. And if the air is not prepared for the lung, then the lung doesn't function optimally. So now we still are alive and we're breathing, because mouth breathing doesn't kill you immediately. It's not an acute injury, but it is a slow deterioration over time. So what happens with nose breathing is that when we're nose breathing and everything's functioning beautifully, we maintain a balance of the ingredients that kind of run us. But like a car runs on gasoline. And if you have a proper gasoline in the car, it should function beautifully. If you mix the gasoline differently and you start to include other ingredients, there's a point where the ingredient list is altered enough that the car's not going to run well. So if we think about a car and gasoline, what if we sprinkled in a little water? Now, if you put a tablespoon of water in that gas tank, it might not make a difference yet. But if every day you put a tablespoon in the gas tank and all of a sudden it's growing, then let's add something else. Let's throw a different ingredient in there. We could throw in any ingredient. Well, let's put some Gatorade in the gas tank. Whatever it might be, if you start to say, hey, we've got a gas tank that's 30 gallons. Let's do 29 gallons of gas and 1 gallon of water. How's the car going to run? Let's do 28 gallons of gas and 2 gallons of water. As you increase the pore ingredients, things start running differently. Mm-hmm. You're going to have a problem with that car. It will malfunction. Well, a human being, the ingredients are oxygen, carbon dioxide, and nitric oxide. So carbon dioxide, oxygen, and nitric oxide, these have to be in balance. So these are our ingredients in our gas tank. Well, the idea is if we're nose breathing, what happens is the nose not only prepares the air for the lung, but nose breathing allows for the lung to do its job perfectly. That's how we keep a balance of those three. Having a proper balance of oxygen, carbon dioxide, and nitric oxide in a child, proper lung function, delivers a well-running or functioning child, human being. When we mouth breathe, all of a sudden mouth breathing is totally different. So what happens with mouth breathing is it changes the balance of those things. So with mouth breathing, we don't get the filter, the warm, the humidify, the accelerate. Basically, the air is not prepared for the lung. When the lung doesn't work right, the balances shift. So oxygen, carbon dioxide, and nitric oxide, when they're out of balance, it creates a change in the child. Physiologically, we use that fancy word to mean, how are you functioning? Well, if you have different ingredients, you function differently. One of the top things it starts to do is affect the cardiovascular system, the heart. And the heart and the vessels that are attached to it, when those ingredients are different, that system runs differently. It can affect the digestive system. When those ingredients are different or altered, then the digestive system functions differently. Mm-hmm. Our, you know, brain function is different when those ingredients are altered or different levels. So basically, when we're thinking about nose breathing, it's the nose breathing that prepares, you know, the air properly so that the lung receives the air perfectly, can do its job in exchanging the ingredients, maintaining proper balance. As soon as a child is mouth breathing, well, how did we get to mouth breathing? We could back up one step and talk about that. So if we have underdeveloped jaws and what we would call a compromised airway or a smaller airspace to breathe through, automatically what happens is the body begins to look for a better way or a supportive way, and we call it compensation. If you can't breathe well through your nose, if there's more resistance to airflow through the nose, what'll happen is the mouth will open. Now, I know when we say the words mouth breathing, it has a very negative, you know, connotation to it. And no one wants to be called a mouth breather. It's used in a negative sense. Oh, you're a mouth breather. It's in the movies that way. Mm-hmm. Mouth breathing, people think of, oh, your jaw's hanging open and your chin's rubbing on the floor, like a look, a certain look of a mouth breather. But we back up a step and we call it lip seal. Because when you breathe poorly through your nose, what you get is a break in lip seal. And mouth breathing could be as subtle as the lips are just apart. It doesn't have to be wide open, gaping, sucking air through your mouth, which would be in a comedy, so to speak, movie scene. But when you have poor nose breathing, thanks to that compromised airspace, because the jaws were underdeveloped, all of a sudden you start to compensate and the body does it automatically. It's not a choice. You don't think about it. Same way we don't think about breathing. We just breathe in and out. Happens naturally. When we start to breathe and the air doesn't flow well through the nose, automatically the lips will separate. The body will separate the lips to allow air to leak in. The trouble with that is it tends to snowball, meaning once you begin mouth breathing, a little bit becomes a little more, becomes a little more, becomes a lot. Next thing you know, you might notice that, hey, there are children who predominantly mouth breathe as opposed to predominantly nose breathe. So the worse the jaw growth and development is, the worse the airspace is, the more likely you will see mouth breathing. it becomes on the top of the list of things a parent might notice. One of the things would be the crooked teeth and the bad bite. Another one would be mouth breathing. If you recognize that your child is mouth breathing, you do have an airway compromise and you have a child who will struggle with some symptoms down the road that we were talking about. So in the medical community, you might find people who understand that there's a big difference between nasal breathing and mouth breathing. Nasal breathing is very healthy for you, and mouth breathing is probably one of the most unhealthy things a human being can do. There are medical professionals who see it that way. There are those who don't. And there are medical professionals who feel like, oh no, if you can breathe through your mouth, it's okay to breathe through your mouth, but it is not. I'm here to share that. Mouth breathing is wildly unhealthy for any human being at any age, and any amount of time delivers a slow deterioration that affects how the body is running.
Yeah.
So basically, we turn into something that is malfunctioning, but in a chronic deterioration state, it tends to become your normal, as opposed to an acute injury.
Yeah.
So I could go into that example of the difference between acute and chronic real quick. It helps parents to kind of see. Yeah. When we think about the word acute, it means kind of instant, and chronic means over a long period of time. So if we're thinking about like a medical condition that would be acute, we would think about a broken leg. So let's say I went for a bicycle ride and I'm riding my bicycle and I'm doing great right up until I crash. Now, if I crash and break my leg, my broken leg is an acute injury. I have a broken leg. I didn't have one a minute ago. I crashed my bike. Now I have a broken leg. With that broken leg, that acute injury, it needs immediate attention. Everybody knows, hey, leg's broken. You better get that fixed. So there's acute. But chronic always doesn't get, you know, the same attention. It's totally different. Now, a chronic thing would be something that is slowly deteriorating over time. And it's so slow over time that it feels like you're normal. Well, mouth breathing delivers a chronic deterioration to a human being. Mouth breathing is possible and you stay alive and you can walk around and you can be nose breathing 1 minute and then start to do a little mouth breathing and you're not going to fall down. You don't have something visible that has to be fixed right now. It's not like a light switch. But what happens with mouth breathing is as we're mouth breathing, all of a sudden the body gets used to it and it becomes habitual. And next thing you know, you're doing more mouth breathing because it's easier to get the air in there than it is your nose.
Yeah.
So if you have an underdeveloped airway and you can't breathe well through your nose, it's natural and basically a compensation that you would start to mouth breathe. But as you're mouth breathing, your body learns it's easier. I'll do this. More mouth breathing leads to more mouth breathing leads to more mouth breathing. So what happens then is we're mouth breathing day and night. The problem with mouth breathing is now the lung doesn't work perfectly and the ingredients are going to be imbalance. If we have an imbalance in the ingredients, all of our systems are going to be slowly changing and deteriorating. So what we talk about as mouth breathing early on can lead to later on down the road, maybe some snoring. All of a sudden now you hear it. We're not just lips apart with air flow through, we're snoring. Well, snoring can lead to the next level, which is even worse, which we call obstructive sleep apnea. Obstructive sleep apnea is the opposite of a broken leg. It is not an acute injury. So a human being who has a diagnosis of obstructive sleep apnea and wears a CPAP to bed, there's no pathway to obstructive sleep apnea where the day before you didn't have it
right.
And you were nose breathing perfectly.
Yeah.
So you cannot be a human being walking along and living, nose breathing, no resistance, you're perfect. And the next day you have obstructive sleep apnea.
Yeah.
That's not an acute injury like a broken leg is. Obstructive sleep apnea is a gradual deterioration to get to that. And when you back up from obstructive sleep apnea, you had like airway resistance syndromes, upper airway resistance syndromes, big long names that are fancy. But prior to that is snoring. Mm-hmm. And prior to that is mouth breathing.
Mm-hmm.
But where did you get your mouth breathing from? The air didn't flow well through your nose. If the air doesn't flow well through your nose, there's a reason for that. Your jaws were underdeveloped.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think about a broken leg being an acute medical injury, it gets attention immediately. Obstructive sleep apnea doesn't get attention until it's the end stage. The problem with that as being a chronic deterioration is that process began early in life. And it's the young child that isn't nose breathing beautifully that is on the pathway to becoming an obstructive sleep apnea adult in the chronic deterioration category.
Yeah. That this is just fascinating. One thing that there might be a question, why does an underdeveloped jaw lead to a difficulty in nasal breathing?
Yeah, great question. So when we think about our anatomy, that answer lies in the anatomy. So I say underdeveloped jaws. We have an upper jaw, we have a lower jaw. Fancy word for the upper jaw is the maxilla. The fancy word for the lower jaw is the mandible. Well, it turns out the maxilla that we say is the upper jaw, it holds our top teeth in. So I have top teeth here. So the top teeth are in my maxilla. Now, the maxilla holds my top teeth in, but the maxilla is much more than that. So I'm going to use my fingers because I'm going to make this triangle to help everybody see. I have a roof of my mouth. Everybody has the roof of their mouth. Their tongue can touch it. So the palate. We say palate, roof of the mouth. The roof of the mouth is the maxilla. So I'm going to use my thumbs to be the roof of the mouth. So the roof of the mouth are my thumbs. Well, these side walls, my fingers that are like goalposts here, this is basically my nose. So I'm kind of drawing with a triangle my nose, my nasal chamber. Well, it turns out the maxilla, it goes from the teeth all the way to the border of the eye. And it makes up the side of your nose. So when you're thinking about your nose, if we took away all of this, we'd see a triangle. That triangle is for breathing. Now, the roof of the mouth and the walls of the nose are your maxilla, your upper jawbone. When the jawbone, the upper jaw, is underdeveloped, when it's smaller, it collapses like this. The palate goes up higher. We call it a vaulted palate, but the roof of the mouth rises up and the walls collapse in. Basically, what we're watching with underdeveloped jaws is compaction. So we have compaction up, so the ceiling is rising and the walls are coming in. It makes a smaller triangle. So a fully developed maxilla delivers a broad, wide palate with walls that are far apart, making it easier to breathe through your nose. But when we have an underdeveloped upper jaw, it collapses like this. We have a high vault of a palate, narrow walls. Next thing you know, you can't breathe well through your nose. So underdeveloped jaws lead to nasal cavity or nose airflow resistance. The air doesn't flow well through a small space. The smaller the space is, the worse the air flows, and your body triggers the lips to separate. So you basically get nasal airflow resistance, or trouble breathing through the nose is directly caused by an underdeveloped upper jaw. Mm-hmm. No airflow room.
Yeah, great explanation. People don't really realize that the roof of the mouth is the floor of the nose.
The roof of the mouth is the floor of the nose. Where are you looking from? Right. You know, if you're exactly. The tongue, you're looking up. Hey, that's the roof of my mouth. But if you're the brain looking down, hey, that's the floor of my nose.
Yeah.
And we forget over time that the maxilla isn't just top teeth. The maxilla is your nose. It builds this complex.
Yeah.
So of course, when the upper jaw is smaller, you have less room to breathe through your nose.
Right.
And the mouth will compensate.
I love the analogy that you made with the gasoline. The one that I've used with my patients is you can take your child and feed them McDonald's and Wendy's burgers, and they're still going to be alive when they're 20.
Yeah.
And you can take this child and feed them, organic fruits and vegetables and pasture-raised meats, and they're going to be alive when they're 20, but you're going to get two totally different kids. You're going to get kids starting chronic diseases at a very early age versus ones that have a very long health span before the chronic sets in.
Oh, I love your analogy. It's probably better. That's a better analogy, because then you're dealing with
you
health.
You live on both of them. You survive on both.
You can survive on both.
One you thrive.
One will be thriving.
And the other you're just surviving.
The other one, it's actually, surviving, and the words I like are the chronic deterioration, because if you were living on junk food or fast food as your three meals a day, you're right. You stay alive. You'll make it to 20 or whatever, but you're going to be deteriorating. You're going to have medical ailments. There are going to be symptoms associated with that so-called, high sugar content and fast food type ingredient. The processing and the preserving of the food changes, for the human being to process that. We start to malfunction.
Yeah. I loved what Dr. The pediatric dentist that you had on your program.
Dr. Kevin Boyd.
Yeah. He talked about lifespan and health span.
Yes.
Lifespan in the United States is around 80, probably a little more for women, a little less for men. But health span, so lifespan is basically how long we live.
Yeah.
Health span was how old you are when chronic disease sets in. And I think it was somewhere like in the late 20s in the United States, 28, 29-year-olds getting a chronic disease like diabetes or atherosclerosis or high blood pressure. That is the difference between someone that can breathe well and someone that can't breathe well.
Yeah.
They can both live to be 80, but one's life is going to be totally different than the others.
Yes, absolutely. And Dr. Kevin Boyd is one of my early mentors. So I was introduced to Dr. Kevin Boyd probably 15 years ago or so. He's one of my early mentors, helping, guide me into this direction of doing early childhood growth and development so your child could have properly growing jaws, better breathing, better sleeping, healthier kid kind of thing. So I owe a big debt of gratitude to him kind of guiding me down the direction so I could stay on it well. Mm-hmm. But his explanation of lifespan, health span is beautiful.
Yeah.
And we start to see that. And that's, would tie into your analogy with the food that you eat almost immediately. In other words, you know, if you're nose breathing, you're going to have this pathway. And if you had a healthy diet, you know, you're going to have this pathway. And those two are a good combination.
Yeah.
Nose breathing human being with a healthy diet can have a long health and lifespan. But if you introduce the opposite, mouth breathing and or an unhealthy diet, there is a possibility you could still live to 80 years old, but you're going to have less of those years healthy.
Right.
And so what they're noticing in medicine is that the health span is shrinking,
mm-hmm.
and we're spending more time unhealthy than healthy. Yeah. And so the goal would be for a human being to be born and go all the way through its life and have their health span and lifespan be the same. If your health span and your lifespan are equal, you basically lived your 90 years, you laid down and went to bed one night and you didn't wake up. And you were healthy for your whole entire 90 years. You had your physical and your mental capabilities, and you functioned beautifully. And you were outside of the medical community for treatment for the so-called, you know, inflammatory or degenerative or chronic disease states that pick up. Meanwhile, the unhealthy diet, I think a lot of people understand that one rather quickly, that if you lived on fast food, how quickly you could become unhealthy. Well, mouth breathing, you should consider that similar. You know, for people listening to this, if you understand that if you only ate cookies, and we love cookies for dessert, having a cookie, I eat a cookie. I like having cookies. I have some ice cream. Like, I'm not saying you can't have dessert. But if you only had dessert for three meals a day, if it was cookies, ice cream, and more cookies, and that was your food source, you're probably going to have an unhealthy life.
Yeah.
Well, mouth breathing is the same thing. For people who didn't think or know about the difference between nose and mouth breathing is like having dessert for every single meal. And that's not really sustainable for health going forward. You're going to be in the category of a shorter health span. And lifespan, you know, the lifespan, you know, has an average life expectancy. But when your health span is short, that makes for a lot of difficulty. That's not quality of life. What you're looking at there is a decrease in quality of life. And it could be, you know, you're trying to minimize the difficult years. And to have them be equal means you're nose breathing with a healthy diet, and you could have a list. Well, there's some exercise involved. You can't just lay on the couch all day either. So there's a list of things. You know, way back when, before I knew about any of this, if someone asked me, you know, what is the key to being healthy for the long term, I'd say, well, eat good food and get some regular exercise. You know, I'd probably start with those two, because what did I know, you know, 20 years ago?
Right.
I would say eating good food, getting some exercise, you know, balance of those things, probably be a good start. Today, I know totally different, that number one would be, I'm a nasal breather. I breathe through my nose, number one. And then because I breathe through my nose well, I sleep well. Those two are together, because you could throw sleep in the list. But if you take that list and you say, well, I can eat well, I can exercise, I can sleep well. You know, the sleeping component, which we're going to get into, the sleeping component is directly related to how you're breathing. So I would put the list today at, if I want to have lifespan and health span be equal, be as healthy as possible for as long as possible, it's nose breathing is number one. You need to establish your nasal breathing and be nasal breathing for your entire life, day and night. After that, you could go to nutritional balance, exercise balance, and then lifestyle balance. Because there are people who have their nose breathing, they have good nutrition, they have good exercise, but you know what, if they're a workaholic, that could factor into the mix. If you're going to work, you know, too much, and you don't have balance in your life, that could be an unhealthy piece of the puzzle.
Mm-hmm.
So I would begin my list now with nose breathing, followed by the nutritional component, and then followed by, you know, some physical. A human being is meant to move.
Right.
So if you could keep the physical activity going, that'd be my top three going forward.
Well, and also if you're an obligate nasal breather, you're going to sleep better.
Yeah.
And if you sleep better, you're going to have more energy to exercise. And if you exercise, you're going to feel better, and you're going to be motivated maybe to eat healthier. So it's either a glorious cycle or a vicious cycle.
Yeah.
one of the other. But I'm with you. It's more than just one thing, but it has to start with something, and that's where it has to start. You can try to have a healthy gut all you want, but if you're not breathing well and not sleeping well, you're never going to have, you know, gut health is real popular subject now. And I agree. I think it's very important. But if you're not breathing well, if you're breathing through your mouth, you're never going to have a healthy gut.
Exactly. Total agreement.
Maybe healthier than if you didn't do anything, but you're never going to have a healthy gut.
Right. And so when you think about the healthy gut and the things going on and what are the, let's say, treatments or solutions to improve the gut. Well, it would begin with converting mouth breathing to nose breathing,
right,
in my world. But if we didn't do that, then what we're doing to focus on the gut and trying to change that outside of changing the breathing pattern, what you're doing is you're really then just treating the symptoms.
Yes.
And in treating the symptoms, we can get probiotics and we can have, I'm sure there's a list of things that can be done, but it's very difficult to make that system run beautifully when there's mouth breathing upstream.
Right.
And so a lot of the, if not most, you know, of the medical conditions and symptoms that we see today have a connection to poor breathing and poor sleeping.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, if you're going to think about treating the cause of something, you go back towards, well, what's the body's number one need? And a lot of people answer fast and say, well, oxygen is like the number one need. Because you could think about, you know, breathing and nutrition, because how do you fuel a human being? Mm-hmm. Well, you got to breathe in and out because you need oxygen. And that's the quick answer. But really, it's not just oxygen being appropriate. It's balance of the ingredients. So that's why I said oxygen, carbon dioxide, and nitric oxide. When those three are in balance, now you have healthy.
Yeah.
Because you could have oxygen at 100. But if your carbon dioxide and your nitric oxide are off or low or altered, that's still an imbalance. Mm-hmm. So oxygen at 100 or perfect doesn't mean you're good. It's the balance of the three. So when you're thinking about having, you know, the balance of those ingredients, well, we think about the air we breathe, then we drink. So water is a good ingredient. Then we eat. So now there's food, there's water, there's air. You know, what's the body's number one need? Well, it's really the breathing. We could think about time without. You know, how long can a human being go without food?
Right.
You know, it's a loose rule, but about 3 weeks without food and you have big troubles, right? Mm-hmm. Water, we back it up to 3 days.
Yeah.
A human being, 3 days without water, big trouble. But then we talk about, well, how about air? Breathing.
Not very long.
Yeah. Not in weeks, not in days. Really, it shouldn't even be called in minutes. It should be seconds. We should be saying 180 seconds.
Yeah.
So when you're thinking about air and balance of the ingredients for a human being to function properly, you might only have about 3 minutes or 180 seconds without it. So it's your body's number one need is to be fueled by the breathing mechanism. Mm-hmm. So it's not just that you have good oxygen. Are you breathing through your nose? Now you're doing well. Then you could talk about the liquid, so to speak. Now in a natural society, way back when, it was only water. So you go back way back when, it's only water. So water is probably the number one ingredient that you could be in the liquid category drinking. Everything else is second best and maybe not so healthy.
Yeah.
And then, of course, food. We covered a little bit of the nutrition already. What are you putting in, you know, to fuel yourself? So if you have good ingredients all the way around, you're probably going to function better and not malfunction, so to speak.
Right.
And then it becomes the balance in the beginning, not just oxygen, but the balance of the three ingredients make for a healthy human being.
Yeah. Man, that's amazing. This is so much more than I ever expected to get from our first in the series.
Well, thank you.
It's awesome, though, because this really set up. So we talked about, Ben hit on earlier, there's all these different, what we call comorbidities that occur when people don't breathe well and in turn don't sleep well. So the next several parts of our series are, we're going to look at those comorbidities, and they're going to be shorter broadcasts, but Ben's going to dive right into, for instance, ADD in children, enuresis or bedwetting in children. ADD in adults, for that matter, and bedwetting in some adults as well. Some don't grow out of it when they're not breathing well. You know, cardiovascular disease and things like that. These are all comorbidities that we're going to touch on in the next several series in the broadcast. But it all goes back to poor breathing, mouth breathing, and not nasal breathing, which is the healthy type of breathing, which I think Ben did a tremendous job today explaining that to our listeners. So, you know, I thought I followed Ben now for several years. I've really immersed myself into all this, and I still learned some new things today. So, thank you, Ben. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
From a selfish standpoint, but it's about helping our patients. That's what it's all about, and about creating awareness in this podcast to moms and dads and to people that are suffering out there and to doctors that are listening to this. So maybe they can get interested in helping their patients breathe better. And a great place for, if any doctors listening here, is Airway Health Solutions. That's Ben's group, and they do some amazing teaching. And you can learn so much more about that by going to Airway Health Solutions airway.com, right?
That's correct.
That's your website. Give them a call, talk to Lauren over there, and you can learn so much and get on this journey with us so that we can help people be healthier. Because an unhealthy society is a very expensive society. Our healthcare costs in this country are tremendous, and it doesn't have to be that way. So like we always do at the end of a podcast, we have our guest choose a song. And what song did you choose today?
Oh, I chose Guns N' Roses, Sweet Child of Mine.
Guns N' Roses, Sweet Child of Mine. And any particular reason?
So I don't want to give away my age, but of course I grew up through the 70s and 80s. So I love the rock music, the classic rock music, a little bit of the heavy metal in there. And so the bands like Guns N' Roses, Van Halen, Metallica, Motley Crue, those are some of my favorite bands and music. Of course, being a child through the 70s and 80s, Kiss was in there. You know, you have some really incredible rock music, and it doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah,
like that. We just don't get that stuff anymore.
Yeah.
So I'm still on my weekends, if I'm in a t-shirt, it usually says Van Halen or Guns N' Roses on it. And I'm still a guy putting on, you know, I know the kids use Spotify or Pandora or stuff like that. And I go right to classic rock and I hit the button but they just play that music. I don't listen to other stuff really.
Yeah.
My wife's gotten me going into a little bit of the country music. So I'm starting to appreciate that now.
I had that on very quietly in the car today when I was bringing you over here. Let's listen to Ben's song. Let's listen to Guns N' Roses for a little clip here. Axel just doesn't have a voice he used to.
No.
I heard him sing the other night, and probably didn't have a good airway. Yeah, this reminds me of dental school in the mid-80s. Well, you know, I knew there was a lot of reasons that I like it, but we share the same affinity with music, so that's where I'm at. So I was telling Ben, I actually wrote a song to this music called Tongue Tie of Mine.
Yeah, I'm excited to hear that. Yeah, it should be no surprise, this song, the opening line is She's Got a Smile.
Right, yeah,
that's
exactly.
That's our whole world. You know, the best smile you can have is if your jaws are fully developed and you got 32 teeth.
So absolutely.
I guess there is a connection
that's
there, too.
That's great.
How about that?
Well, Ben, thanks so much.
My pleasure.
We are looking forward to the next in the series of how jaw size and nasal breathing relates to our health and what can be done about it, what to look for. So, Ben, look forward to having you on the next one. This has been Health and Harmony Beyond the Teeth. I'm Dr. Hal Stewart, your host. Have a great day. Be happy. Be healthy. Give someone a smile. It might be the only person that smiles at them that day. And you never know how much you can change someone's life just by a kind gesture or a smile or a nod or, just say hello. So live well, and we'll see you next time. Thanks a lot.